The Marine Corps has always had really four functions within the United States defense establishment. They've served as naval infantry or naval forces aboard ships. They've served as reinforcements or a second land army ashore with the army. They served as sort of a palace guard. That's the sort of service you see with the Marines at 8th and I, the Marines guarding the president, for example. And then the fourth function the Marine Corps has often fulfilled is the function of colonial infantry, where the Marine Corps has deployed to territories overseas that the United States has an interest in. For most of the 20s and 30s, the Marine Corps is really doing three things. They're fighting these banana wars. These require light infantry acting in a colonial manner, Marines acting in a counterinsurgency manner, training indigenous forces with the gendarmerie. The Marines are getting a great deal of jungle fighting experience. Though the propaganda indicates the Japanese were great jungle fighters. In fact, on Guadalcanal, most of the senior Marine Corps officers had much more jungle fighting experience than the Japanese did. Fortunately for the Marine Corps, Major General Lejeune, it's one of its more energetic commandants and certainly one of its most important commandants, had commanded an army division during World War I and understood what was required for the Marine Corps to fight and succeed in a modern battlefield with logistics, staff work, all of the division and even Army and Corps level necessities in place. And so he insisted that the Marines start training that way, start planning and thinking of the Corps as deploying divisions, even though at the time the Marine Corps is just regiments. The third thing that the Marine Corps is doing during this time period is that there are Marines in China. And the Marines in China are essentially observing the Japanese. In theory, they're there to try to curb Japanese aggression against China. They're not particularly successful at that at no fault of their own. It's simply not something that a single regiment and a few scattered detachments in a country the size of China could have done. Very few Marine officers saw the banana wars or colonial infantry mission as a raison d'etre, their purpose in being. Especially after World War I, there was in fact resentment among the officers because there were many Marine officers who didn't make it to France, who were serving instead in places like Haiti and Nicaragua in 1917 and 1918. And they felt that that reduced their chances for promotion, etc. And there were others, most prominently General Smedley Butler, who did deploy to France with the 5th Marine Brigade. But because the Army had already kind of been burned by the publicity that the Marines got from Belleau, the 5th Marine Brigade was never deployed in combat. And of course, part of that is because World War I ended a year before we expected it to. I know a lot of people realize that, but American military planners and Allied military planners expected that World War I was going to end in 1919. They did not expect the German collapse and surrender in November 1918. And by the time you get to the mid-30s, the banana wars, for the most part, have ended. And so the Corps is, from then on, focusing on preparing for the next great war. A lot of American military officers realized that there was going to be a conflict, most likely with Japan, which was expanding, which gained a lot of colonies in the Pacific from Germany following World War I. And so the Americans, especially the American Navy and the Marine Corps at the Naval War College and places like Quantico, began thinking about how a war in the Pacific was going to be fought and what kind of a Marine Corps it would take to support the Navy's campaign. The Navy came up with its Pacific plan very early, and the Marine Corps realized that, well, a specific Marine, a man named Pete Ellis, Lieutenant Colonel Pete Ellis, realized that the Marine Corps was going to be needed to seize and defend advanced naval bases. And he's the first in the Marine Corps to really put it down on paper with his seminal Operations Plan 712. Advanced Base Operations in Micronesia, which was the sort of progenitor of marine amphibious warfare doctrine. Other things to keep in mind is that the switch to amphibious warfare, the Navy was fully behind it because they realized they were going to need these bases. And they didn't trust, or not so much that they didn't trust the Army, but they really wanted their own military force to be seizing them. The Marines are part of the Navy Department. Admirals think of Marines as theirs. And they wanted to be able to say, okay, the bases, these advanced naval bases, we're going to grab them. And this was perhaps more important in this period when you had the War Department and the Navy Department. And they didn't, despite the best intentions, perhaps, always work together very well. It wasn't until the Defense Reorganization following World War II, when we created the Department of Defense, that we began to get close to jointness. And really, the kind of jointness that we enjoy today, the purple DOD, didn't really come into being until 1986 with the Goldwater-Nichols Act. Within the Corps itself, I would say that, that Lejeune's reforms and his that movement, it was all enthusiastically continued. And commandants like Holcomb, who was commandant as we get come into World War II, they continued the that process. They were definitely enthusiastically standing on the shoulders of giants. You had giants standing on the shoulders of giants.